Hello, my name's Stephen Dawson. I play midfield for Scunthorpe United Football Club, and I like to read when I'm on holiday. I also like to read for my two children that are going to bed. I like to read football magazines, and my favourite author is J.K. Rowling.
My name's Niall Canavan, and I'm a defender for Scunthorpe United. I really like to read autobiographies from other sports people. I do this because it's a great way to learn about other people's experiences within the game and also through other sports that they play.
Much for coming to Glanford Park. So my name's Tom, as you know, and I write books. Who likes books? That's good. The sort of books I write detective books, spy books, ghost stories, stories set in wars, that sort of thing, usually about children. But there are also sports books, so there's football books and rugby.
So we're at Scunthorpe United today to help them launch their Scunthorpe United Reading Stars project as part of the Words Count scheme. And the idea is to use the passion and love of football amongst children, especially children who aren't that confident about reading, to encourage them to read for pleasure. So during the football reading game, it's a quiz. There's about 10 questions, and it's all to do with different things you can read. So newspaper questions with a word blacked out from a headline, the children have to guess what that is. A biography of a footballer, and the children have to say who the footballer is. And if they get a question right, they get to take a penalty.
Not a third. Not fifth.
60.
Yes.
A true fan, Thomas.
We were really lucky to have some of the players along today. And they were great. They went in goal for us. The kids enjoyed meeting them. And I think the kids really benefited from hearing that footballers read magazines about fitness, read biographies of other players.
Has reading been
helped you a bit? Yeah, more of other players as well. And like I was saying earlier on, I have two young children now as well. So night times I read to them a lot. Well, try to anyway. And they read to me. Yeah, like you said, I think it's important, really, really important, and just keep doing it. And if you enjoy it, like you said, the girl over there that enjoys writing and all that, then keep going for it and enjoying it, giving it your all to do it.
Yeah, I'm the same. You can read a lot of autobiographies where it's similar, like you said, you can watch, so we can watch football matches and learn from that, but you can also read about people's experiences. And then you can maybe relate to something in that, and you can learn from that as well through reading about things that they've been through in their life. And I just think it's a good way of learning, really.
It is.
It does open your mind to things.
Very good.
When I'm writing a story, I always start off with who is the story about, what happens to them, where is it, when is it, why does it happen, and how has it happened. And that's where I get my ideas for stories from. So when I work with children, I talk to them about their interests, and then we try and devise a story around their interests, or a newspaper story.
Even more awesome.
The police say.
Even more awesome.
Detectives in Greater Manchester have spent 6 weeks trying to identify the unnamed man who travelled more than 200 miles to the moor from London.
So yesterday we worked with some children, and a story in there was a story in the news the last couple of days about a 70-year-old man who walked up a hill. He travelled all the way from London to Lancashire and walked up this hill and died up there. And it's a mystery as to why he was there. And that the police were working on the idea that there had been a plane crash there 60 years ago, and that he may have gone up there even to die near someone he loved. And it's a bit of a mystery.
Any other question words?
Why didn't he have any ID on him?
Why, indeed. That's a very good question. Why?
What? What was he doing?
What was he doing? And this is how I write a story, which we'll come to.
When did he die?
When?
Hard when you're writing. It's hard to start, I've got to write a story, and there's a blank page in front of you. But if you start to ask yourself questions like what, when, why, who, etc., it's a way into the story. When I work with children on writing, I sort of say, the first thing to do is get the story down, write the story really quickly. Don't worry about the sentences, spelling mistakes, structures, vocabulary. Just write it, and then once you've written it, you can make it a bit prettier if you want. And so you can put in the odd fancy word. You can make the spelling better. Make sure the clauses, the rhythm of the sentence is better, and that's what I think. So I think it's important. But if you start children off by saying you've got to write a story and these are the rules for each sentence, it's really intimidating for children, especially children who struggle with that sort of thing. So for me, it's editing is really important, and to make children know that my first drafts are shocking. Really bad, but I write the first draft and then go back to it and try to improve it with a more positive vocabulary.
I went to Moscow, to Russia, where I went to a very posh hotel and spied on Russian billionaires, which was quite revealing. But also, I read this book about Russian football club owners. So I get ideas from...
My inspiration comes from lots of places, so things that... trouble me, things that annoy me. So for instance, I wrote a book about footballers being trafficked in Africa because I'd read about it and I thought it was appalling. But another book, I walked past Swansea City's old stadium, which had been abandoned for the Liberty, and it was falling apart, overgrown, crumbling. And so I looked in there and I thought this would be a great setting for a football ghost story. These boys in the story have to sleep in a football stadium in a tent. So I wanted to camp in a football stadium to know what it was like. So I was fortunate someone at Wrexham Football Club let me camp on the pitch. And that helped me do my research, like what it's like when it's dark and light, what it sounds like, is it scary, what creaks, what makes a weird noise that might be a good prompt for a spooky paragraph, I suppose.
When I was writing this, I went to all the places it was set. So I went to Delville Wood, which is in northern France, where there was a battle, and Bethune, which is where they were based, where they stayed sometimes. And you can look up a list of all the graves and who's in the graves. And so I found Sid Wheelhouse's listed, and it's in this tiny little village. Up in some fields, really, up in some farmer's field.
Anyone who wants to be a writer, I would say, first of all, write about what you are passionate about. If you can talk passionately about something, your hobby, something you really care about, then you will write better about it. So write about something you're passionate about. I would say never give up. If you want to be a writer, you can be a writer. You just have to keep trying and trying and trying and not give up. Like footballers say, the footballers who succeed are the ones who train and train and train and practice a lot. My final thing to be a writer is to read lots of other stuff, read books by lots of different authors, even stuff you don't like, and read 10 pages of it and work out why you don't like it, and then never make that mistake yourself. I started writing when I was about 20. I didn't like reading until I was 17, but my mum eventually got me into it using football and giving me the confidence. When I started reading, though, it gave me... I wanted to do this, I wanted to do that, I wanted to go to places because I'd read about them, and reading stories and non-fiction really gave me ambitions and confidence, really. It sounds quite dramatic thing to say, but I truly believe that reading is at the core of a good society and civilization.